Okay, this is a talk on data and network security. So my name is Marsh. So let's get started. So the simplest way client authenticates with the server is by using a username and password. You send a request for some access to something, and the server will ask you for your username and password. And if you supply the right username and a password, this is a basic HTTP authentication. You can get the resources on the server. Now let's look at the next login. And the second thing is, how do you know the server is actually the right server? Because it's asking for your password. The server must have a certificate. So when you try to access something, first the server sends you a certificate. You actually check the certificate. And that certificate is valid and is issued by some authority. And if it's valid, then you send in a username and password. So then both the server knows who you are and you know what the server is. The next thing we learn is, so each website has a certificate. First of all, one of them is that if it's not HTTPS, it will say it's not secure. So this means that there's no HTTP in it. And if you click on the right click on the Chrome toolbar at the top, you can see the certificate of the thing. It's valid. It says valid out here. And how many cookies are used. And the certificate is issued by google.com on this date from 20 to 20 and issued by this authority. Okay, so this is the certificate that came from the server. Let's look at the next slide. So the main thing about passwords is how complicated it should be. So because what happens is, once you have a password, somebody can try randomly and try to guess your password. So there are many ways to guess a password. One is a brute force way, which is the number of choices to try. So if you just use alphabets, that 26 into 2, uppercase and lowercase, and 10 digits, so which is around 64, a bit less than 64, so that is 6 bits per character. And you multiply it by the length of the password. So you get and if it's a 5 character password, you get 5 into 6, 30 bits. 30 bits is around 9 digits, which is 1 billion choices. So you can get 1 billion different passwords out of alphabets and digits, 5 character. So then the issues are basically how much time does it take for a hacker to try each password. Suppose they can try 1 million passwords per second using a really fast machine. So what we do first thing is to rate limit it. So don't allow too many, try a lot of passwords. 3 times you try it and you're blocked. If you get a wrong password, maybe you are rate limited or blocked for half a minute or 1 minute, then you can try one again. So the thing is, the server doesn't have to store a password. Server has to store the password at a one-way hash. So that if the hacker gets hold of the server database, they can build a table. It's called a rainbow table and of all the guesses. And so to avoid the hacker from building a rainbow table of all the passwords in the and finding the right hash, you attach some random digits to the password when you hash it, and then you keep the digits along with the password in the database. So what that does is called a salt. So each password can have multiple different salts, so that the hacker cannot build a rainbow table easily. So what problem we have? Users cannot remember long passwords. So they use common words like pet names, addresses, date of birth, and they reuse the password on different sites. So then that's the problem. The second problem is the man in the middle problem, MITM. Third parties on the network can be listening. So if somebody sees your password go by on the packet, they can actually reuse it. So of course, SSL encryption prevents network sniffing. But we should be aware of it. If it's leaking, somebody can see your password while it's transiting from your computer to the server. So the question is, who cracked the Enigma encryption in World War II? Okay, so this guy is Alan Turing. Also the father of Turing machine. So the practices that you need to, as a developer or a, is to never share your passwords. Never put your passwords on the internet, and at least use 8 characters plus 3 digits plus a special character. Special character means not alphanumeric, but not a control character. and not a Unicode or something, so that it's easy, it's ASCII, so that between 0 and 256, 1 to 256, so that it's easy to store, and it's uniform across different services. And different password on different sites. Change your password every quarter. So you can randomly generate passwords, not from known words. So you can do passwords like this, dd, and input file is dev urandom. That's a random number generator on Linux and Windows. Also Sigwin. And this is the 12 characters and ones, and no other logging. And then you convert it to base64. So you get like 12 character approximately of password. Second thing is to use MFA, multi-factor authentication, two-factor authentication on AWS, Linux, Gmail, Facebook, Insta, Twilio, Hotmail, all these services. Two-factor is basically the password changes every time you try to log in, the second password, the second factor of authentication. It's not the same. So even if somebody has your password, they need to have the second authentication password generator to access your accounts, to log into your accounts. Okay. So other good practices are to lock your screen, laptop, whenever you go away, and encrypt your development machine hard disk, so that even if you give it for repair, nothing can be copied of the hard disk if you change hard machine. Other thing is to don't run any unrelated streaming or games on your dev machine, because you never know what the software is doing. So don't install software from unknown sources or unknown sites, because even good software from unknown sites can be backdoored. And regularly look at audit the software running in a machine. You can open a Process Explorer or PS and see what processes are running and what they're doing, or the network netstat to see what networks are, what processes are connecting which networks on your machine, from your machine to other machines. And if you see something strange, you have to delete those processes, stop those processes. So what is PII data? PII data is personal identifiable information. It's your name, your phone number, email, date of birth, your profile image, your ID, addresses, etc. First thing about PII image is it is protected. So don't download any PII image onto a machine except for support or business needs as per terms of use mentioned in the website. So, and also when it's used for any purpose for customer support, you should delete the data after usage. And also log why you accessed the data and what you did with the data, to what kind of support did you help the user with something. And the other thing, as a code, in the code, never log PII data to the logging files or security tokens into log files, paper trail, GitHub, wherever. Just store references to the user ID, not the actual data. So only people who accessed to the database can actually see what user ID refers to what personal data. Okay, so this is about personal data safety. And what is OTP? OTP is a one-time password. And how do you get it? So to log in, you need your user ID, you need a password, and a one-time password. It could be it's called a second factor authentication or multi-factor authentication. And these OTPs change every time, every minute for login. They're difficult to reuse except by social engineering. Somebody has to call you up and say, hey, like, I'm logging in, can you give me an OTP? And generally, it's not a good idea ever to share your OTP. So one way to get OTP is by SMS. And the second one is by RSA ID. This is the RSA ID is used by banks and stuff. It generates a new number every second. And when you try to log into bank, you need to type in a number here. And every device is different numbers. So bank knows the device that you have. So they know which number will be generated out here. But you can't open it and see how it works. And every device gives a different number every second. So time has to be accurate. And the battery, so if it runs out of battery, you'll get a new one. But this is expensive. So nowadays we use Google Authenticator, which is a software-based OTP generator. So Google Authenticator app is a user ID. It changes every minute. So it is a username and a six-digit code it generates. So basically, server is asking what is the hash of time and the QR code. And the client, we compute the hash of the time and the QR code. This is the QR code. It's a long string. And then you hash it and send it back. So it's used by Gmail, Amazon, Facebook, everybody to add full login. So open protocol. So anyone can implement it. So basically, the next problem is we're looking at is how do we communicate over an insecure channel? Basically, exchanging password is unsafe. So what you do is, one way is to you encrypt your data, lock it with a key, secret key, and then you send the locked data, and then the receiver unlocks it with the same key. So the man in the middle cannot see what data is going by, so because it's locked. But the problem is, both the user and the receiver need to have the same key, and if you're like far apart, it's difficult to send. So you have to send the key over a different channel. You can't send it on the same email or same network because this person is listening to everything that goes on the network. So how do you get around that? So but the problem is how to exchange keys. Like when you start out, you want to give a key to the server and the server's key to talk to it, and server needs your key. So Jack is a victim and Peter is the man in the middle and Jill is the other victim. So everything you send the key, this guy copies the key, and then Jill sends the beta, he decrypts it and sends his own key. And then when she encrypts it and sends some data, this guy will decrypt it with his key and send it encrypted with Peter's key to Jack. Jack sends his account number, this guy will open it and repack it for Jill. And then, but the thing is, he will change the number out here. So he can change the number. Man can actually change the number if he has a password access to something. So let's see the login protocol. So basically, it's like trying to verify the user by asking a question that only the user knows. So this guy asks some random question like, do you know his phone number? Yes. He said, prove it. He gives a phone number. Is this a good protocol? This can only be used once, because once it's used, Alan also knows the phone number, whatever. So next time, and if he doesn't know the number, he knows it now. So you can use it again and again. Okay, so it's a one-time use thing. So the second thing is to randomize it or like not get a whole answer. You can say only like, do you know his phone number? He's only the 650 something something. So he's got it right by 3 digits, but he's not told the whole number. So again, there's a problem out here. So every time the challenge is given, do you know the number? The other person learns a part of the number and eventually he knows the whole number. So let's make it more stronger. So he'll actually not ask for the same thing. Alan will say, what is the last digit? Instead of asking like the digit, he will actually randomly pick up part of the thing to ask the like what's the last digit, and Bob says 4. So now it's 1 out of 10 chance, or it could be like what are the last 10 digits or something. It could be a very long string. Is it a good protocol? Still I think same thing, that slowly Bob can learn the whole thing from Alan can learn the whole thing from Bob. So let's try another one. What is the sum of the digits? So now you know it's a 36, so both of them can compute the sum, but they can check that the sum is correct and then he can log in. But the problem is, can you actually find out the number from the sum? It can only be used a few times, because if you have enough data on information about the phone number, you can actually compute a phone number in this case after many rounds of reuse. So what we need to do is hashing. Hashing is a fingerprinting. Hashing is a one-way function. You can compute the fingerprint, but you can't get the account number from the sum. So fingerprint looks like this. It's just a picture, but idea is that it's a thing that it's a long string of a number, which is a hash of the MD5 SHA-2 or SHA-256 of a input string, which is one way. So given the string, you can compute a hash and check, but given the hash, you cannot do the reverse function because there are too many choices. Okay, so let's try one-way hashing. Do you know each one? Yes, prove it. What is the hash of the digits? SHA-2. He gives the hash part of it. Is it a good protocol? Again, so first one, this thing is that eventually it can be used only fixed number of times. So let's try hash plus challenge. What are the first 3 digits of the hash? He says the sync. Is this a good protocol? Again, like it suffers from, can be used. Hash to numbers can be computed using rainbow tables. and server has to store your secret key to verify answer. So basically, in a really secure protocol, you don't even want a server to have a copy of your password. So how do you do that? Is it possible? So we come to zero knowledge proofs. It's a protocol. Zero knowledge protocol is a method by which one party, the prover, can prove to another party, the verifier, that a given statement is true without conveying any information apart from the fact that a statement is true. So it is used in credit cards and stuff. We look at that. So this is where the one-way zero knowledge is stored. So some math is required, and it can be used forever. Forever means like billions of times without loss of private information. Rob can prove he knows the number without revealing anything. So that's why it's zero knowledge. You can prove that he knows the number without actually telling the server what number it is. So it's used by SSH login. The server challenges the user to prove that she has a private password by sending a encrypted random number, and that's a challenge. And then the user will respond with a response will be compute the same thing on the client side and send a response back, right? Because he has a private key, he can compute the hash again. So let's see how it works in details. So basically, we use public key and private key. So what is public key cryptography? Is basically Alice, the user, generates takes a large random number and generates a public key and a private key. Private key stays only with her and it's usually kept locked. And the public key is sent to a server. So everybody can have a public key, but given a public key, you cannot compute a private key. And so that so public key can be used to encrypt and private key will be used to decrypt. So how does it work? Bob wants to encrypt. He takes Alice's private key, public key, encrypts her some data, and then Alice uses her private key to decrypt it. So this works, but then nobody else in the world can decrypt except Alice, because only she has a private key. So you have to keep your private key secure and don't leave it around, or at least lock it on your, and it should not be world readable on your machine. And preferably only in your .ssh directory somewhere, in your home directory, SSH directory, which is not readable by anybody except you. So how do you share a secret? So now what you can do is, so both Alice and Bob have public key and private key. They both generate their own keys and they both publish their public keys and keep their private keys with themselves. And then Alice can take Bob's public key and her private key and create a shared secret. And Bob can do the same thing with Alice's public key and his private key and create a shared secret. So both can create a secret without actually sharing knowing their private keys or something. So this allows you to two people to talk on the internet without actually meeting and having a secure communication. The man in the middle cannot have the private key. So they only has a public key of these two public keys. And unless he has one of the private keys, he cannot take part in the conversation. So, and the second uses for, one was first was encryption. Second was you can use it for signing. So Alice can use her private key to lock it, the signature, and then send it to Bob. Now, anybody can take Alice's public key and verify that if the public key can open it, that means it's only Alice's public key will open it. And then Bob can verify, okay, this is from Alice because nobody else could have locked it. So the public key and private key for each user are unique. And if you lock with one, you need the other one to unlock, and vice versa. And if you sign with one, you need the public key to verify the signature is correct. So that's public key and private key for signing. It's used for everything almost in cryptography. Second is an example is single use is OAuth token with limited validity. OAuth is an open standard for access delegation, commonly used as a way for internet users to grant websites apply access to the information on other websites without giving them the password. So you want to send some data to somewhere else. So what you do is, instead of giving them your password, you give them a token, authority token that's valid for a short time, and you can use it to the website can give it, or you can generate a token that you can use it to other sites. It's a short-term password, you can say. So example is a Java web token, and it's used with a signed data. Basically, you take a header data and a secret, and you create a signature, add it to GWT, and give it to the client. And the client gives it to, you say GWT, and sends it for verification. And he compares with the original to see that the secret and the header has a secret, and you can compare that it really matches. So next thing is cookies. Cookies are temporary IDs sent by the server to the client browser to identify the user. So normally they should be secure. That means only HTTPS only, and not and if you make it HTTP only, they are not visible to JavaScript, because JavaScript can actually do a lot of damage, especially scripts that are not vetted. And it has cookies have expiry date. That means after if you shut your browser or something, some cookies go away, and you need to regenerate the cookies. That's why you need to log in again if you close your browser. And also, they're not visible to JavaScript. They're only useful at the login time. Or some of them are, there are two types of cookies. One is secure and insecure ones also. They're used for just for tracking purposes, third-party cookies. That means third parties can also add cookies to your thing, so that whenever you browse the web, they can track the ID, but not really anything else except that you're the same person without knowing who you are. So sometimes, and if it has the cookies are only valid on the issuing domain, so the browser only send a cookie back to the domain that issued the original cookie. So Gmail cookie won't work on YouTube. So Gmail will have to do a auth and send you somehow tell YouTube that you're the same ID. Okay. And what are the issues with it? XSS, cross-site scripting. The third party JavaScript injection into your website. So this is a problem when another party's code is in your website and they actually basically run something on your website and collect information and trick the user into sending information to another site, which was not your intention. And what is SQL injection? Is that when user types in some username or something and you say insert into database, but instead of username, they type in a script. And if you don't vet it and you try to execute a SQL statement, it may have other commands inside it, drop tables or something, and it will be injected into your and will drop the table in the SQL instead of adding the username. So what is the weakness in the code? Not validating user inputs. And then there are also weaknesses in servers. Basically, servers are not rate limiting or not checking the size of the input. That can all damage the server, slow down servers or crash servers if the username is very long or some field is very long. So those checks should be added to the server side and client side, because client code can be, user can generate his own client code, but the server code has to be recheck whatever the client sent. You can't assume that the only person sending data is your own client code on the browser. So other places where public key is used in SSH, GNUPG, SSL, and it's used by GitHub, AWS, Google, Facebook, Microsoft, credit cards, and SIM cards. So how does it work? So this is the public key, the private key. The lock has two keys. One is for locking, one is for opening. Okay, and the public key anybody can use. Anybody can use it to send you, to lock the information, send it to you. But you need your private key to open the box and read the data inside. But then your key is always protected by a passphrase. Should always protect it. So that if you drop your key also, other people cannot use it unless you know the passphrase. And it's normally in your home directory .sh, it's called .pub. And this is a PEM format key, the private key. So how does SSH work? You can log in a million times, billion times into SSH without any information, revealing any information. You never send your password to the server. The server challenges, takes a random number and encrypts it with your public key and sends it to you. So you can only open the challenge with your private key and send the answer back to the server to prove that you have a private key. Server lets you log in. Okay, that's the SSH protocol. So since the private key is so important, even you don't keep it use it, you give it to the agent. And whenever you need to log in somewhere, the agent will, your agent keeps a private key. So you cannot lose it accidentally, you never hold a raw private key, not even on disk. So when challenged, you get a key to the agent. Agent will give the answer to you, which you give to the server. So this way, only agent has it in memory. Of course, if somebody hacks into your as a root, they take a memory dump of your machine, then you're in bigger trouble. But agent also normally keeps the thing encrypted. It will only generate as needed the responses. So smart cards, what are smart cards? The SIMs and credit cards, they contain a private key or more commonly a symmetry key called KI. The card is designed never to reveal this key to the outside world. So there's a key inside this, it's never revealed. So you cannot read the data from the card except by destroying the card. So it's impractical to clone a SIM card. So only way to use it is like you ask a question, it will give an answer, but won't tell you what the key is. So let's look at how to set up SSH key. You create a SSH key with this command, SSH key gen, and you put it in this file, mykey.pm. Then you add a password to your passphrase to your PM file. So you put some passphrase. Then what you do is generate a public key out of your PM file and put it in your server, in your SSH authorized keys. So when you try to log in the keys, the server will look into your account, into your account, and this keys, if there's a public key out there, it will use that key to verify that you are the user of, you had a private key for this key to log into that server. And you need to put it in the server in your home directory, in this .ssh authorized keys. So Linux, let's look at a client setup on Linux. So generally all the setup is done inside a .ssh config file. So it's a file, basically it contains all your configurations for SSH login and GitHub and anything else that you need to do over secure network. So for every host, you can give it a username and a host name, or it could be IP address, and which key will open that file, identity key, this PM file will open it. So what you do is first, when you log in, you evaluate the SSH agent. It will generate a few environment variables. How to talk to the agent. Then you give the agent your key. It will ask for a password, and then it will be running in the background. It will keep a copy of your password in memory. When you try to log into the server, the SSH will ask the agent for the server will send a challenge, and the SSH will send a challenge to the agent. Agent will give the answer back to you, to SSH. SSH will send the answer back to the server to prove that he has a password, and then you can log in. And on Windows, we have something called PuTTY. And page agent is it basically similar to SSH agent, holds a key in memory, and it'll ask for a password of the PM file and hold it in memory, this key. So when you try to log in with PuTTY, minus load this server, PuTTY is a UI for login, terminal UI, and PuTTY will ask page agent to authenticate to the server. So page agent is floating around the background of your Windows machine, holding your private key for authentication. So what is the other use of SSH? It's a SSH tunnel, it's like VPN. So normally, you cannot talk to a database. Normally databases don't allow remote connections because of security issue. Otherwise, there's a lot of data in it. So what you do is, basically you need to create a SSH tunnel from your machine or your network to the server network where the database is accessible in this network. And so there's a firewall protecting, not allowing anyone to access this thing, this database. And so first the SSH tunnel will encrypt this channel. From this server, it will forward request to the database. So this is also how VPN works and also SSH tunnel works. So an interesting story about the public cryptography is that Diffie-Hellman and Merkley invented in 1976. The idea is basically Merkley puzzles is that they're easy to check that the solution, if somebody gives a solution to a puzzle, you can easy to check, but you can't solve the puzzle if you don't have a hint how to solve the puzzle. So it's implemented in the RSA using large random numbers, like 100-digit random numbers. The idea is basically numbers are easy to multiply but hard to factor. given a 200-digit number, you can figure out what the two integers are that generate that number. But given a two integers, you can quickly multiply them. So the story about Merkley is that basically he was registered in an undergrad computer science course and he proposed public key cryptography, but his project was not accepted. But eventually it became the underpinning of the whole internet, the public key cryptography. So another application is in blockchains. So instead of having just one level in hashing, you can have blocks of hashing, and then you have distributed hashing. So each server can hash a part of it, and then they keep taking hashes from each other and building a tree of hashes. So it's called a distributed hashing. It's called a Merkley tree. So every transaction that happens, you generate a hash of it and add it to the tree. So all clients are doing that independently, creating a tree, and then they bought. So that's how Bitcoin works, and blockchain works. So this is basically in Bitcoin. So basically a block header is a root hash and tree. So any part of the tree can be computed by anybody to check it's correct or not, if you have the parts of the hashes. So if you want to learn more about it, you can look up zero knowledge proofs in Wikipedia, RSA public key exchange, Diffie-Hellman, and Felton Bitcoin lectures online, and YouTube you can find them. They're like 10 lectures from Princeton. Merkley tree is a Bitcoin, using Bitcoins. GPG is public key, GNU, public key cryptography tool. SSH is a secure shell, and Google Authenticator. And the book reference is Applied Cryptography by Bruce Schneier. Okay, thanks a lot. This is the end of the